Two things I'd like to add as part of what Sonali said is that, you know, very rightly, over-serving the kids does many things. Like, you know, their mind starts to accept these large quantities as they grow older. And so, you know, they're literally feeding their eyes more than themselves. So they say that, you know, for children till the age of 12, you give them as many tablespoons as their age, as a serving of every food group. So we try to give them adult servings, and then we stuff it, and they don't experience hunger to eat then. And then we don't make the connection that I should only eat when I'm hungry, but I should eat when I see food. And you know, that's a huge issue, you know. So till they're 12, they do that. And the other thing is, I think what Sonali's also implementing is the 80-20 principle. That means 80% of healthy food can dilute, you know, the 20% of unhealthy food. Yes, there is, in a sense, that the American Heart Association says that 20% of our healthy diet can be recreational calories.
You know, I'm going to use this 80-20 today. I'm going to tell my son, you know, we are going to do the 80-20 principle.
Yes, you could.
Also, I realize that when you tell them these terms, they get very excited, and they feel they're so grown up that you're sharing it with them, that they see, you know, I'm doing it like a
grown-up. 80%, so it's the reverse Pareto principle. The Pareto principle says that 20% of people who work in an organization contribute to, you know, 80% of their revenue. But as far as health is concerned, it's the reverse. So, and what happens is that, you know, the 20% is taken care of because it's a variety, it's a drop in the ocean, and the body can fight it. A healthy body can fight that. Yeah.
And also, just kind of emphasizing and making it a point that, look, we are walking rather than taking a car or this, you know, when you're on a holiday, because, you know, all those ice creams that have gone in, come on, let's walk it out. And you know, in any case, kids are happy to skateboard and to scooter. Yes, like I said, it's just that little bit of effort that you need to carry a couple of things which will make it interesting for them to use their feet rather than be happy to sit in a car or get into a bus or get into, you know, where they're driven around basically, then using their own feet. So it's great exercise for me, and it becomes like a play for my son when he's on that little scooter or on a skateboard. So it becomes like a game, and we are even like burning those.
Yeah, for the most part, you know, your activity is your nutrient calorie intake is determined by your activity level. So if you're sedentary, you have to eat less, and your diet is really boring. But if you're active, you can do so much.
Super, super. You know what? I'm going to actually walk back to the video that we saw of Indira Nooyi, and where she kind of talks about having to deal with guilt on a daily basis and saying there's really no out there. You know, if you're a working parent, you're going to face the guilt and all of that, which is what my next question, actually, Anjali, to you is, you're ensuring your child's physiological well-being, and you're ensuring the family's eating right and all of that. Do you think it is vital to kind of, you know, focus teeny tiny bit on yourself as well, and maybe that kind of manifests into something bigger?
You have to listen to your body. Body is so beautiful. All the time, you can't be dictated. And all the time, I am a nutritionist. And it was initially a very big joke because I would all the time look at from nutrition point of view. So when I got married, and I am a Panju, so who came from a very disciplined family background, and I got married to a typical Panju who started to think about food at 9:30 in the night, कि what's going to get cooked for dinner. It was a kind of a shock for me to accept this thing. Because my body clock is at 7, it starts to ask for food. But very subtly, I brought about a change, explaining it was not a one-night affair, कि okay, from next time you start to follow what I have to say. So it took me a little bit of time, but also gave me this learning that all the time you can't be dictating terms. You have to let go. And by doing that, believe me, you are not letting the other person think about his that little piece of enjoyment all the time. If you let it go, sorry, you are making your life much more simple.
I would also like to draw on your vast experience here, and I'm guessing, you know, the job of a nutritionist is not just restricted to eat this, here's your meal plan. I'm guessing there's a lot of counseling involved in how important does mental health feature in all of this for the woman, you know, empowering her to take care of the family.
See, when I practice nutrition, nutrition is never practiced as nutrition alone. It is a combination of nutrition and the psychology of the person. When I'm interacting with one client, I'm not the same person with the other client. It is based on the initial time which I spent with the client is to understanding that client. And on that, I built my nutrition story. It is not, okay, this is the universal diet plan. A person also follows, the B person also follows, the C person, it does not work like that. Each requirement can be very, very different with each individual. So it is whole set of things that you need to take into account while following a nutritional pattern.
Thank you. I think we're just about ready to wrap up here. So I'm going to actually be a Baba Gyani here and sum up all that I have learned today. And I think my last takeaway from all of this is just that it's very important for a woman to kind of focus on her health as well. And, you know, that is kind of going to give her the strength and, you know, that is going to empower her to take care of the family. In fact, not just that, I was admiring this about both you and Madhuri as well, where they mentioned that, I'm so particular. I take care of what I eat. My children see what I'm doing. And, you know, by default, by example, they follow. So Nali here has managed to convert and make her mother-in-law a believer, a Punjabi mother-in-law a believer, which is a big deal as well. So I suppose once you're feeling whole and complete is when your environment is going to change, yeah? Ladies, this has been so inspiring. I have taken back so much. I'm guessing all these wonderful people here have too. I'm going to do one thing. We're going to open this the floor up for questions. If you have any, then please feel free to post them. You guys just came for the almonds, no? Yeah, absolutely. No, I did too. It's all right to be honest. No questions at all. So Nali, if you have a question that you want to pose to the nutritionist or anything?
So I want to know the ratio of Pilates and weight training that you do in a week.
Yeah, so I typically do Pilates every morning because it's anti-movement training now that, you know, that has caught my attention. We move too much and don't move the part of the body that shouldn't be moved. And so that I do that, a lot of plank holds, a lot of dead bugs, new exercises. I do weight training every day. I love my muscle.
Yeah, I do. I'm reaching the stage where my best friends are my muscles, and I'm really looking for them. I have very little of those.
You know, you can change your muscle composition based on the diet. And you know what's really interesting now, as per the new research, is that you want some. It's not so compartmentalized anymore into breakfast, lunch, dinner. And we have to look at protein adequacy. And I think we were talking about genetic nutrition, because the power of nutrition lies in silencing the bad genes from expressing themselves. So that's a huge new thing that's coming up. And these wonderful little nuts are part of that silencing package, yeah.
Tell me, why almond milk and not cow's milk?
I would say, when you exercise, after your exercise, before you exercise, you require a simple carb source in small portion. that is your biggest factor which will help you to mobilize your fat. That's precisely why you are exercising. After you have exercised, so just look back at your physiology, what all has happened. You have mobilized your fat. In other words, there is plenty of energy which is present in your bloodstream, right? But still, after exercising, you are very, very hungry, right? So you require, the culprit is typically 90% of people, what they do is that they will come back home and eat another carb source. Body is not asking for energy. It's not asking for that sugar to come back into the bloodstream. Right. If you are having a carb source, it means the quantum of sugar body is going to liberate. It will again get converted into fat and stored inside your body. What body is demanding, the culprit is fat because it has got mobilized. If you take in protein, then it works beautifully. Because post-workout, because the body has enough quantum of energy present. So how will body take your protein source? It will say, protein, go and perform your function. It will help you to build your muscle. Now, the question which you have asked me is, why almond milk and why not your cow's milk? There are two facts which I'm going to state. First fact is, if you look at the protein content, almond milk has fair quantum of protein in it, but it also has other factors more than your cow's milk, which are your antioxidant, anti-inflammatory agents. Then it has a very powerful antioxidant, which is vitamin
anti-inflammatory.
E. Yes. It has a lot of anti-inflammatory.
Yeah.
And
vitamin D.
Vitamin E, which is a very, very powerful antioxidant.
Correct.
So when you work out,
your skin and hair.
Exactly, exactly. So if you talk about right from cosmetic to your food, everybody is talking about antioxidants and anti-inflammatory to be added inside your body. It is higher in that. The other factor is milk has something called as lactose. It is a disaccharide. I'll explain to you what disaccharide is. It is two molecules of sugar. When they add together, it forms a disaccharide. But still, it is a simple sugar only.
Right.
It is lactose which is present in your milk. But if you compare that simple carb in the almond milk, it is considerably low. So I would say a person can actually switch over to almond milk.
Yeah.
Yes.
Or at least have it as part of your several milks that you have, definitely. That would be good for variety.
What I would like to say is that, so it's not a bad idea to kind of switch to almond milk in the cereal.
So Nali, I'll suggest another thing.
Come back from your workout, you want to have something solid.
Yes.
Hmm? So the ideal combination would be a milk cereal is what generally people tend to have. Mm-hmm. I would say bring down the percentage if you are having it, let's say with cow's milk. It is also nutritious. I'm not stating ki don't have, but I am telling you how relevant it is to switch over to almond
because
milk.
We don't do that kind of activity.
Right.
You know, we have sedentary lives.
Right.
We are getting into our lives. We are not going to fields and working, or we are not doing that kind of physical labor anymore.
Right.
We are at a desk somewhere or something, you know, in that zone. So we understand that we have to do that workout because that's the way we are moving our body. But as soon as we do the workout and we come back, then like you said, with the cow's milk, we are back to square one basically.
Yes.
After
the quantum of simple sugar is definitely high.
Exactly. So it will be a healthy choice for the lifestyle that we have in cities.
Obviously.
To move to almond milk. So it's okay to move a child to almond milk also, right?
Why not?
Safe.
Yes, absolutely safe.
Okay.
Thank you.
I think this was fantastic. Our questions got answered here only. How lovely. So I'm guessing there are no questions here. I'm going to invite the lovely Sonika to come back. Hi.
बहुत अच्छी चर्चा है ये और हेल्दी चर्चा है ये. मज़ा आया, बहुत सारी चीज़ें सीखने को भी मिली एंड कुछ चीज़ें जो मुझे लग रहा था कि शायद मैं ठीक कर रही हूँ या नहीं, बिकॉज देयर वर टू न्यूट्रिशनिस्ट ऑन द पैनल, तो मेरे कुछ सवालों का जवाब भी मिल गया मुझे. मज़ा आ गया.
अभी बड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग चर्चा है, क्योंकि जो हमने जो टॉपिक हमने निकाला है कि वर्किंग वूमेन का डायलेमा, वो इंक्रीजिंग डायलेमा हो रहा है. क्योंकि आज जब इंडिया में देख रहे हैं कि काफ़ी औरतें अभी वर्क प्लेस पर जा रहे हैं और जा रहे हैं अपने इनकम इंक्रीज़ करने के लिए, और दूसरी चीज़ बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है, अपने आइडेंटिटी को फाइंड करने के लिए. एक होममेकर का आइडेंटिटी है, पर उसका उसके बियॉन्ड उनका आइडेंटिटी क्या है, वो इंडिया के लिए बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट स्टेज है, और उसको हमें सपोर्ट करना चाहिए. और एक चीज़ सपोर्ट है कि वो अपने हेल्थ के बारे में देखें, अपने फैमिली के हेल्थ के रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ले पाए. तो ये चर्चा से काफ़ी इंडिकेटर्स आ गया है कि वो कैसे कर सकते हैं. बहुत सक्सेसफुल हमारे पैनलिस्ट थे जो अपने अपने पर्सपेक्टिव दिए. मेरे ख्याल से ये जब इंफॉर्मेशन जनरल पब्लिक को जाएगा, उनको बहुत हेल्प करेगा.
Well, you know, it's a joke because I never go anywhere without my pack of badam in my bag, because I'm hungry, and if I don't eat on time, I get hangry. So I really start getting very, very irritable if I'm not fed on time. So there's always a bit of nuts in my bag. And like I said, even now, if you open my bag, you'll find I have a little dabba which has this thing in it. Also, like all the cars, like my mom-in-law's car, my husband's car, all of the cars will also have little almonds in it, because at any point of time, if you're stuck in traffic, you're getting delayed sometimes, you're not going to reach on time, then what happens is when the hunger builds up, you end up eating junk, because then you start craving, and then you just want to satisfy that hunger, and you're eating all wrong foods at that time. So instead of that, when that meal time is coming, and if you're going to take longer to prolong that say like my meal time is 1 o'clock, but I know that by the time I get to my meal, it's going to be 2:30. Then I will snack on a little bit of badam and, you know, have those almonds. It just satiates me till then, so that I eat a healthy meal again and I don't end up, because if I don't, then I end up eating all kinds of junk food. See, for my son, I would say like what he was saying, for a working mother to see that a nutritious meal is done. So if you can innovate these badams, you can make it in different recipe and kind of plan the meals, it makes life easier. And as an actor, yes, definitely important to, you know, take care of your health. I think everybody needs to take care of their health. We are living in cities, we are living sedentary lifestyles. We really need to move around and eat properly, you know, eat food that is not just appealing to your taste buds, but make it appealing to taste buds while being healthy is what is important. And that is what I think I aim at doing. Workout karna bahut zaruri hai. बहुत बड़ी टिप है ये, कोई शॉर्टकट नहीं है उसके लिए. वर्कआउट रेगुलरली, ईट हेल्दी, दैट्स द बेस्ट वे टू अ हेल्दी हैप्पी लॉन्ग लाइफ.
सोशल मीडिया एक ऐसा प्लेटफॉर्म बन गया है जहाँ हर कोई अपने व्यूज रखता है, अपनी बातें करता है, चाहे वो हेल्थ को लेकर हो कोई भी. तो अभी एक सॉन्ग आया है रिमिक्स, एक दो तीन माधुरी जी का रिमिक्स बना है जिसमें जैकलीन ने परफॉर्म किया,
तो उसमें आमंड्स का क्या कनेक्शन है?
एक सवाल आपसे जानना चाहेंगे, आपको कितना पसंद आया?
मैंने देखा नहीं है.
मिक्स रिव्यूज भी आ रहे हैं उसको.
अच्छा, सो आई एम डेफिनेटली ऑन सोशल मीडिया, लेकिन यू नो मैं हमेशा कहती हूँ कि प्रॉब्लम्स भी दुनिया की सारी एक आदमी चेंज नहीं कर सकता है. सो यू हैव टू फोकस ऑन व्हाट यू कैन डू. तो आई फोकस ऑन व्हाट आई कैन डू ऑन सोशल मीडिया. आई रन अ लवली बुक क्लब ऑन सोशल मीडिया एंड आई फील दैट सोशल मीडिया इज़ अ वेरी पावरफुल टूल विच कैन बी यूज्ड वेल और कैन बी अब्यूज्ड ऑल्सो. एंड आई वुड लाइक टू बी अ पर्सन हु यूजेज द टूल विच इज़ वेरी पावरफुल इन अ गुड वे. एंड आई थिंक माई बुक क्लब वॉज द आइडिया ऑफ द बुक क्लब वॉज दैट टू काइंड ऑफ यूज इट इन अ गुड वे, इन अ पॉजिटिव वे, इन अ कंस्ट्रक्टिव वे. एंड वेरी फ्रेंकली आई ट्राई नॉट टू सी नेगेटिव एंड नॉट कंस्ट्रक्टिव थिंग्स ऑन सोशल मीडिया और इन न्यूज़ पेपर और इन न्यूज और इवन रीड स्टोरीज, बिकॉज I think mental health is very important and that's part of my mental health. So I don't look at negative stories.
But then also, do you really like the song?
I have not seen it. Yeah, so.
You want to ask?
Okay. You want to ask anything? Okay. Thank you.
This note, let me introduce you to our esteemed panelists who are very successful professionals in their chosen field and above all, loving mothers to their children. We have with us today our moderator, Shehtaz Mirza, who is a famous radio jockey with a popular morning show on Radio Mirchi FM. She will moderate our discussion today. And now let me introduce you to our other panelists. We have Emily Fleshman, Senior Global Director of Marketing at Almond Board of California. Emily leads the strategy and implementation of Board's global marketing investment, including both consumer and trade activities. We have the beautiful Sonali Bendre with us today, who is a successful actress and author, homemaker, and a reality show judge. We have Madhuri Ruhia, who is a well-known fitness, posture, Pilates, and nutrition expert. We also have Ms. Anju Sood, who comes here with over 25 years of experience in the field of nutrition. She is an expert in the fields of diet and weight management. Thank you, dear panelists. I would now request our moderator to start with the discussion.
Hello. Hi, okay. Good afternoon. She's already introduced me. Shehtaz Mirza is such a responsibility. Just people know me as Shezi. One quick correction over there is that there are fantastic mothers out here. I am mother to a puppy.
my challenges are just as important. But you know, we're at a place here where we have such fantastic panelists with such different, diverse ideas to share. So you know, I'm really excited, and I think we should kickstart this whole thing with a video. If I could just please, thank you. For everybody who doesn't know, and I'm guessing you would, this is CEO of PepsiCo, Indra Nooyi, please.
I don't think women can have it all. I just don't think so. We pretend we have it all. We pretend we can have it all.
Circumstance to be a mother and a working mother at that. You know what? Like I said before, we're so fortunate because we have such diverse conversations that are going to start off with. Can I start with you, Sirali, please? And I would actually like to understand, you know, how much of a challenge is it as a working parent in your daily life? Can you give us a bit of an excerpt from your life, please?
Good afternoon, everybody. And it's great to be here. Nice to see you all. And I'm sitting on a panel of extremely talented women here. My day is pretty normal in a lot of ways. It's the same thing like what she was saying. Am I being the mother, the wife, the daughter-in-law, daughter, or the sister, the friend, or just me at some point? So there are times when in the day when I get lost being all sorts of other, playing all sorts of these other roles, which are not the roles I played in my career, but they're all there. And then there are times, then there's that one bit of time where I dig out and find some time, which is my me time, which for me has turned to be my coping mechanism, as she was saying, which has been my me time. The guilt factor is also true. It does come in. I think we are all kind of conditioned to it. It's in our DNA, it's in our subconscious to be guilty about a lot of things. As mothers, we feel guilty. As daughters, we feel guilty. I think somewhere, as women, this is kind of in our upbringing or in our subconscious of as a society itself, that even if we are too happy, we start feeling guilty about it, you know, literally. So it's just, the guilt is not just about being the mother, it is guilty about things. So these are the things that as you grow and you kind of realize it and you start correcting it and, you know, saying that no, you use the word was beautiful, the coping mechanism, and you start finding out how you can manage it. So my day is sort of normal for the longest part of the day. I get up, send my child to school, do housekeeping, get some meals off and finish off the work and everything, attack all that. And then sometimes from afternoon, or there are days when it's a shoot and it turns into a completely different kind of a day. So suddenly I'm a very, very normal housewife or a mother or whatever. And then when I go onto the set, I am everything that I'm not in the house. So like what I'm looking like now is exactly opposite of what I would probably look like, with the hair all over the place, trying to cope with getting things and getting the son onto the school bus on time, etc., etc. So in certain ways, it's very similar to any normal woman. And in certain ways, it's not. So both of that is kind of a North Pole, South Pole situation for me, where my profession calls me to look a certain way. And then, you know, when you look at the pictures and you get a feeling that, oh, this is a glamorous life and this is so, everything is so perfect and everything. And you just realize that nothing is ever perfect. And behind the glamour, there's a lot of hard work. And that's how the day goes by. So it's not too much different from what it is with other women. Only the celebrity part gets a little different. That's what it is, I suppose.
Isn't that comforting to hear? You can be Sonali Bindre and still feel guilty because, hey, we're conditioned. Thank you for that perspective. You know, so we have two wonderful nutritionists on the panel here. I'm going to try and spice things up a little. First, I'm going to pose a question to you, Madhuri. We can get technical data out and everything, but what I really want to understand is that, you know, you are a nutritionist. You have everything on point. You know, et cetera, et cetera. This needs to be done at so and so, et cetera. But you are also a mother of two young, dynamic girls. So I want to understand the challenges of a nutritionist at home. You're a working parent and you have two girls. So
yeah, every time I serve something on the table and it's not healthy, then my children say that, Mama, but you're supposed to be a nutritionist.
So, you know, I have to be double-time nutritionist with my girls because both of them are also into fitness. And one is 26, one is 20, they're dancing into fitness.
Wow.
And so, you know what we recently started doing is making that, you know, the whole morning is gone into making our meals. So we have about 4 or 5 meals that I cook with my girls in the morning, every morning. So, you know, because if the morning is taken care of, everything's taken care of. And then, you know, we really talk a lot about nutrition now. And earlier, it's much easier for me. Let me confess, it's much easier for me to provide nutrition for my girls when they're into fitness right now, unlike when they were much younger. Because, you know, then they have those, I don't want to eat this, I don't like this, I don't, you know. So now I say it's going to be healthy. You can do 20 more squats with something like this. Oh, let me go ahead and, you know, have that. So the challenge has changed now because, you know, I guess I've been the role model for my children and they've also adopted the fitness way. So we're all about, you know, discussing nutrition. And the other day, my Parisha said that, Mommy, you know, I believe this particular food is not that great anymore. I said, so show me the research. I mean, where is that come from? So it's really a little different. But I think, you know, planning and packaging small, tight, nutrition-dense meals is the way we go.
Fabulous. Yeah? Fabulous. Thanks, Madhuri. Anju, I want to ask you a question around this only. But, you know, in the course of your career, on a day-to-day basis, you interact with so many working mothers. I'm guessing there must be some semblance of a pattern in that. There must be a few common questions or issues that they have to deal with as well. So, you know, what are they? Can you kind of just elaborate a little, please?
Definitely, there are two observations which I have made. First observation is the fulcrum of your balanced diet, as well as balanced, I'll put it like this, balanced meal and healthy snacking, and your exercise or physical activity, it has definitely drifted. People have moved on to something called as unhealthy meal patterns and unhealthy snack times and sedentary lifestyle. This is the first observation which is common. And the second observation is the onset of lifestyle problems, which we call it as ex-metabolic syndrome problems like overweight, obesity, hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular profiling, then PCOD, hormonal imbalances, they have started to happen at a very, very younger age category. So then from the client point of view, the similarity is basically the eating pattern. I would put it like this, ki, probably the awareness level in terms of nutrition is less, and secondly, the time frame is definitely less. And once you correct it, to very large extent, you are able to bring them out of these problems. And if not out of these problems, you inculcate a management regime for them where they are able to manage with their problems.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You know, I'm, like I said before, not a mother to a human baby, and I'm only now understanding the importance of what it is you ladies do on a daily basis. And you know how you mentioned that we are conditioned to feel guilt as women. I always thought that it was just an Indian woman construct. But to offer me perspective about what goes on in the West, I'm going to trouble Emily, please. I really want to understand how different are the, you know, like day-to-day problems that these wonderful ladies discussed here. How different or how similar is the issue in the West?
Well, I think the guilt is a global issue for moms. I do think that there's something innate in the way that we are either raised or just brought into the world that causes us to carry guilt with us in a lot of ways. My life is a little different because my husband actually stays home with our kids. And so we made that decision about 6 years ago. And with my job, I travel quite a bit, and we just determined that it was a lot easier for us to have one parent at home helping. It's a lot more expensive in the United States to have nannies and other helpers, and so that was the way we kind of managed it. But it doesn't remove the guilt. I often have to think that it's a great thing that my kids have their dad with them, and remind myself of that, because they will always have a connection to me because I'm mom. And so they're building some time with him, but it's hard. It's still time away for work or going to work out or traveling. It's tough. Yeah.
Thanks, Amy. I'm going to take this a little technical now. So what I want to understand is, it's like she very rightly said that she has a stay-at-home dad for a husband, but at the end of the day, let's just understand the fact that a woman is perceived, and rightfully so, as the primary caregiver. Madhuriji, as a question to you, what would your advice be to women who have to manage their family health and, you know, the overall physiological well-being of their, 2.4 kids and their husband, etc.? Any tips? Because there are going to be challenges to make sure that everybody's eating right.
You know, I think the first thing is that we have to be ready to take on the challenge. You know, if we find that the challenge is so daunting and we don't want to take it on, then we've lost the battle right there. So, and it's really, it's very easy. I'm really saying that. It's really easy to do if you look after yourself. And if you look after yourself, it's contagious that you start, you automatically become a role model so that others become just like you. So I remember, the flight attendant saying, put on the oxygen mask on you first before you look after. Yeah, so that is clearly that's something that I believe in. It's also about planning. I know planning can get very boring. Lists, to-do lists are really things that we don't end up doing. But a little trouble taken in that respect really works. Because, if we do something for 5 days at a stretch, then automatically the body takes over, the brain takes over, and you don't have to go on replanning and things like that. And get the family involved. Let's all get involved in doing. We all want to be healthy, right? So why not do something about
beautiful,
it?
Yeah? Beautiful. A little while ago, we were having, all of us were just sitting and having this conversation, and Anju happened to mention something really valid about, planning and, involving the family, and maybe there might be fewer challenges. So can you kind of just share that?
See, if you are involving your family and planning it, believe me, 90% of your work is done. In the sense, at the same time, if you are involving your entire family, you are at the same time educating them. Like she beautifully stated, ki it is your mind game. For a couple of times, you need to plan. After that, mind will definitely take over. But see the response. If you are involving your family, you are educating them also, which is what you are wanting to do, to inculcate that right, healthy habits. You are definitely doing that along with it.
Great. Okay. Sonali, I must ask you this. You're an actor, you have a hectic life, your husband has a hectic life, your kid also would want certain, Mama Aji, I want this and I don't want that. And I'm guessing your husband would also say, no, I don't like that, I like this, etc. So I just want to understand, in terms of family health, how does it all fit in for you? How do you manage? Do you plan?
Well, I'm a Maharashtrian married into a Punjabi family, and I think most people here will understand how different this, food-wise, how different this is, So imagine, the Maharashtrian food is definitely not something that the Punjabis enjoy, and the Punjabi food is like, when I got married and I went and I said, what's the occasion? Because every day the food, the table is laid out like there's a party happening. So I'm like, what is the, is somebody getting married? And I don't know about it, it's like that. So I think what has happened over the period is that we've kind of come to a sweet middle sort of a thing where we are not probably as frugal or healthy as the Maharashtrian in the general table, but we are not as extravagant as the Punjabi table used to be also. And that balance has been, and also in the timing, because there was suddenly the night meal was happening at 4 a.m. in the morning, and so the lifestyle was all over the place. So for me to get that into some sort of, the first thing was to get the pattern of eating and to getting the hours right. So having said that, what you said in that, I would like to say what you're saying is absolutely true, that we lead by example, and if we can involve the family, it gets better. But because of when I was on my book tour, and I had written a book on which is called Modern Gurukul and my experiments with parenting, a lot of mothers would keep coming and asking me a question which is very relevant for here. Generally, in Indian households, it's a joint family. And believe me, I'm lucky. I live in a joint family which is accepting the changes that I want to and are open to the fact that, yes, it is good for us to make these changes. But there are a lot of times when you're in a joint family, the mother of that child, whom you want to inculcate that healthy habit in, it does not in India have that freedom of forming that menu for the day. And that, I think, is the biggest challenge that in India we face. The joint family is great in its support system. I mean, I can be a working mother because I have great support from my mother-in-law, from my mother and my father, my sisters-in-law, fabulous support system. But the same support system can be a really difficult thing also because, quite frankly, when my child was born and when he started eating everything and from the eggplant to, it was like, आलू नहीं खा रहा बैंगन दे रही है इतने से बच्चे को इट वॉज सच अ शॉकिंग थिंग यू नो सो देन स्लोली या एंड देन स्लोली व्हेन यू नो यू टॉक अबाउट द स्टडीज एंड यू टॉक अबाउट द थिंग माय मॉम इन लॉ वाज ओपन टू द आइडिया एंड शी सेड यस यू नो व्हाट दिस इज परफेक्ट एंड इन फैक्ट इफ एनीबडी एल्स शी सेड यू नो दिस इज व्हाट हैपेंड लुक एट माय चिल्ड्रन दे आर ऑल डीलिंग विद वेट इश्यूज टुडे एंड रियली आई डोंट वांट माय ग्रैंडचाइल्ड टू डील विद इट आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू इंटरफियर विद इट यू डिसाइड व्हाट यू वांट टू डू Exactly, you know, what I realized is that most mothers-in-law don't do it. They do not want to let go of the control. They think they are right. And they are not letting the mother, so, you know, they're kind of undermining what the mother is trying to do most of the time. And that, I think, is the biggest challenge where Indian women are concerned. For that, you know, to having, so that's like a, then you have to be a politician, a diplomat, and while being the mother, daughter, sister, etc., you have to be that also to kind of give it. So only thing that I realized is that you need to give it a lot of time because you can't just say, this is what I want to implement. It just needs to be given a lot of time where you spend the time to explain things, you get them on board. See, once they get on board, it's a beautiful thing to have your family together. But that getting on board is not something that happens suddenly. You have to work on it and you have to give it time. So that, I think, was a bigger challenge and, you know, to deal with that sort of a zone than actually the meal planning. That became the easier part then.
Fantastic. You mentioned Marathi and Punjabi culture, madhe so much tras, so many issues.
It's not tras, it's different.
Yeah. No, but can you imagine, in India itself, Emily, who is from the US and has very closely examined life in Singapore, culturally, you know, trying to adjust and manage family health. You've studied both cultures and, in great detail. How much of a difference is it? And, you know, what according to you, problems that you would face in the US and, not so much here?
I don't know that I can say not so much. I mean, I think the issue of having in-laws or extended family living in the house and influencing food, I actually get stressed out thinking about that because it's not very common in the U.S., but I think of what my kids are fed by their grandparents and they're loving and great-grandparents, but it's a lot of indulgence. And I think that would just come in the house and would be hard to deal with. But, you know, I think the issues are similar. You know, kids want to have food that's delicious and there's a lot of, and that's global, and there's a lot of opportunities for them to find that. And so really, it's just about the taking the time to plan, taking the time to pick your battles, and I think that's a big one as well, is deciding, you know, what are the parts of their day that you're going to focus on, what is your strategy as a family going to be to, influence good nutrition. In my house, we talk a lot with our kids about food and the nutrients that foods bring to their life. And it's great. My children are 6 and 8, and I hear them talking about things like they know that meat offers protein and is good for their muscles, and they know that calcium is good for their bones, and that various vegetables are good for them. Some of them they like, some they don't. But it's great to see that coming through.
Okay, but you have to hold on to the mic a little longer because a little while ago we were having a conversation. She mentioned how kids are really all about wanting to eat yummy food. And, you know, as a family, you need to kind of encourage and inculcate that habit. There was a very lovely story that she shared with me a little while ago about a little one, her daughter,
yeah,
was at home with her husband and said, no, I don't want green beans. So, you know, I'm going to let you tell that, and I'm waiting for the conclusion of that.
Yes. So my husband and I had a conversation that my daughter, she's a carb-loving little child. So bread, corn, all of those things, she just will eat all of them all the time. And we had had conversation about trying to increase her green vegetable intake. And I had to work late one night, and it was dinner time, so probably 7:30. And I get a FaceTime call from my husband, and he was like, I've tried, it's your turn now. So I sat there on FaceTime with my daughter, convincing her to eat green beans, and we had success, but it wasn't without a few tears. But you know, now she'll, you know, it is sometimes the whole idea about giving kids something 10 times to make sure that they like it. We've found that that really works for our kids. They may not love things after 10 times, but often they're willing to eat them a little bit more.
Fabulous. So my understanding from this particular round of discussions is that even maintaining family health is not just the sole responsibility of the woman. Everybody has to contribute, and everybody needs to do their little bit. Yeah, fantastic. We were just talking about how, you know, meals really ought to be planned with, you know, military-ish, you know, precision. But what I want to understand, and this is as a child of a parent too, I want to understand, what happens between the meals? Like, there's snacking. I am hungry every 2 hours, and I'm, well, you know, not a child, so I'm guessing, you know, oh, yay, bag of potato chips, yum, yum, let's just eat and be done with it. So, you know what, actually, let me just start this one with Anjali. Planning snacks. Actually, just give us a technical lowdown, please.
See, in most of the households, what happens is people tend to emphasize on the main major meals, but without realizing your biggest culprit is your snack time. So snack time is the meal which requires a lot of emphasis. And what are the ingredients which are very, very essential to make it as a healthy snack time is the protein component, which in Indian diet by far is typically low in your daily intake. So there is two components which are very, very essential. One is your protein component, which is required, and other is your micronutrients. Micronutrients are those nutrients which are required in small quantums, like your vitamins and minerals. I find a handful of almonds is an extremely healthy and very, very satisfying snack time meal, which can be introduced. It is a finger food where the person, small children don't have to mess around with. They have to simply pick and put it in their mouth.
Fantastic. I'm sorry, continue. Yeah. This is a personal thing. I'm sorry I'm making this about myself. But you know how you grew up with your grandmother saying, ki, beta, saat badam, you know, soak it in the night,
yeah,
and next morning you have the tedious task of spending precious moments peeling it, and then you drain out the water and you see a pretty looking white badam, and you say, now I will eat this. You were telling me something really important about the skin of the almond.
First, I'll tell you what is the logic behind soaking of your almonds. Typically, all your water-soluble vitamins and minerals, they are present around your skin. So when you soak them, they tend to seep inside the grain. So what are you left in the morning is the skin and the almond, which has full nutrition in it. So there is no need to peel that skin, because that is contributing to your fiber part. So I would say highly recommend. So the last bit was fine, but that peeling of skin is actually not required. It is, you can consume it with the skin because it's adding to that fiber.
Okay, thank you.
Why do we soak then?
Soak because around your skin, there are vitamins and minerals which are present. Otherwise, what will happen is the chances are very, very high, until unless you chew them very properly, because the saliva is alkaline in nature. it will definitely dissolve that vitamin and mineral and it will get absorbed. Or else, if you soak it, then the chances are 100%, no? You are getting the complete right. nutrition out of
it. It's like it's bioavailable in the body.
Yeah.
For right. some studies, it is, but I think an interesting point that you made is, yeah, if you chew it very yeah. well, or you have shavings, if you don't like it soaked and you don't like that mushy sort of, you want the crunchy taste, and I think it's very good. I mean, yeah. the you at least 20 chews per almond kind of thing.
Yeah, so you know, getting like meditative. These 20 yeah. chews is a really big issue because yeah. you want to gulp yeah. down things. So what I realized, what worked for me was that you know, when my son goes to school, which is a nut-free school, so it, you know, I can't really put that in his yeah. So that is not going in a school bag. So I've been trying to do, and what has been working for me is make them more interesting. Just almonds are a little boring. You know, like he'll probably you know, want to. Why is it that you want those? Like you said, the crisps and the thing. So I realized that my son likes this tangy and little, what we in India say chatpata. As long as something is chatpata, he enjoys it. So we started, like, you roast them a bit, add a bit of masala to it, yeah. and you know, it becomes such a lovely snack, and then he
almond ale is also a good idea.
Yeah, and you know, also you, I chop them up and, you know, use them to, if you're making the momos, you know, of them, and you kind of roll it in the, you know, like really finely chopped
really
almond
versatile
and all that. So he's yeah. eating it without thinking that, oh my God, because sometimes what happens is he says, oh, you're making this too healthy, these almonds and all, they're very boring. So they don't even realize he's, you know, eating it. So a lot of times you crush it and put it in the porridge, you know, and stuff like that. Like literally when he was a baby, it would be like a powder that's made and kept from with this thing. And I would just like add it and the nutrients are going in. So different ways to kind of do it rather than like me as an adult, I have my pack with me in my bag constantly. I can eat it. But for him, I need to make it more interesting. I'm sure people who have children with a little sweet tooth can make it with honey, you know, and sesame seeds on it and right. whatever. Absolutely. Make it more interesting and yet healthy in that way. Absolutely. A great snack. It
yeah. And the thing great I think snack for husbands you also. Said, you know, it's because of its high fiber content as well, it gives you a lot of satisfaction. You feel full. Mm-hmm. And feeling full is a really important strategy for health and wellness yeah. because if you feel full, then you don't feel like binging yeah. and you don't get hungry very quickly. Yeah. So you're attacking two parts of your health issues, challenges, in one with one yeah. go. And that is why, you know, I guess even I keep, I have a lot of almonds every day.
Yeah. I've already had my 12 almonds and I've got to have some more and I'm scratching my nose. We've already had 12. How many more do you want to have?
I have it in the morning before my Pilates workout that I do myself. So 12 almonds, one glass of spinach juice and a fruit. So that's like my pre-workout. And when I weight train, I want to have like a high fiber post-workout snack.
Okay.
So that's Greek yogurt and 12 almonds again in a smoothie.
So yeah, so you know, these
yeah,
ladies
with
were...
a little bit of protein shake or some chocolate, cocoa flavor. Yeah.
So they were sharing some gyan, if you will, on how many almonds you can have in a day. And I said, oh, seven. Seven is the right answer. And they said, no, child, not seven. So there's a panda you had. Somebody was explaining to me about a fistful of almonds or something, which is fine. Can you please, really, I'm actually very fascinated. I always thought, oh, five or seven, no more. So you were saying that you can have about 23, 24 or something.
Yeah, so you know, I think what we have to really understand is the difference between nutrient density and calorie density. Typically, like Anu has been saying, that almonds or foods that are nutrient dense, that means they are packed, every bite is packed with nutrition. They are typically low in calories as well, which is why then they start working on things like you don't gain weight even if you eat more, then you have the satiety angle, you're satisfied. And then the elements and the nutrients in nutrient dense foods, you know, like a handful of nutrient-dense almonds means that, you know, even the blood sugar is balanced, and that's really big, because if our blood sugar is balanced, we are not seeking quick fixes. The brain is not seeking a quick fix. So, you know, automatically everything gets planned very, very easily.
Fantastic.
Yeah?
I'm...
when we say
sorry to cut you. I have such a shrill voice. I'm going to trouble you to like cuddle the mic like it's your child, please. And hold it close and talk.
Oh, okay. See, when we talk about nutrient dense, how it adds to your satiety, at the same time, there is a slow release of sugar which is happening, which is the most important parameter for you to not get that kind of craving, because slow, little by little, sugar is getting released. Your insulin output and effectiveness in terms of its functioning is also very, very high. The person does not, because that small quantum of sugar which is getting released is surely getting metabolized. But if it is a higher, it's not a nutrient dense, which low on fiber, then what happens is the quantum of sugar which gets released is very, very high. So a chances of a person putting on weight is very, very high, because that sugar will definitely get converted into fat and store inside your body. So almonds, absolutely a good example of food which is a low glycemic index food and sorts your body completely.
Fantastic, fantastic. You know, Sonali, you were talking a little while ago about how you make it so interesting for your son, you know, and you're kind of hoodwinking him into saying, "Are Khale, it's so yummy," and you know, but yummy, yeah, but healthy and how. And I'm just thinking, what a bunch of democratic parents. Because when I grew up, they were just placed in front of me and I was told, eat, you know, and that was done. So, and then as I think evolution happened, parents just said, look, we have work to do, stuff pays here. But apparently, I think just a few months ago, there was a study conducted. And apparently there seems to be a paradigm shift in the mindset of working parents, working mothers, where they are not just simply looking to feed their children, but they're making sure that whatever snacks that are going into their system are healthy snacks. So yes, crispy, healthy, yummy. And case in point, I'm going to make it yummy for you, I'm going to make it appealing for you, but I'm also going to make sure that you know, nutritional value is maintained. I actually would like to know, do you think, you know, in the course of your career, you meet so many people, you meet so many working mothers, is that happening?
Much more so now. I mean, the tide is changing from women are no more in the background, more and more front runners. And, you know, you're not so expected just to stay in the four walls of your kitchen and, you know, sort of backseat drive the self-care, the care in the house. But you are actually becoming a leader by, you know, taking your own personal decisions. You want to be financially independent. You want to, you know, make yourself into somebody. And now the role, I think, for the woman has changed from just a caregiver to a motivator, really. I mean, she's become a role model. The children and everybody want to follow her. And as an influencer in the family, a prominent influencer, she has to be really careful of those lifestyle decisions. And I think this change is really happening. I mean, so I have working women coming to me and saying, you know, what can I do to improve my health? And also that of my children, much more so now than they ever did earlier.
So people are basically now also saying that, yes, let's just snack healthy and be sensible about it.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Yeah, okay. Emily, I want to understand, since you have kids youngish, right, 6 and 8. So I'm guessing for you ladies, it's not difficult. You're explaining to them that, look, you know, nutritional content high, ergo eat. You know, but for a child to, I mean, there's chocolate there. I'm just saying, come on, you know what I'm saying. So how do you negotiate? And I'm going to come back to you as well, because your child is not grown up as well.
You know, I think one of the strategies we've employed is giving them some empowerment. And so we have areas in the pantry and areas in the fridge that are known to have the healthy snacks that are permissible for them to eat throughout the day when they want. Up till 4 p.m. And so that includes nuts, obviously, almonds and other nutrient-dense items. And then in the fridge, there's fruit. And my son prefers almond butter over nuts. So we have a lot of those things on hand for them. And giving them the opportunity to make the choice, they feel really proud. And they'll come and tell us that they made a good choice. And so that works. Not every day, but it works a lot of the days.
Yeah, so first of all, what has helped me is really not keeping most of the unhealthy things in the house at all. So when you go into the cupboard and into the fridge, and you know, that's a new way of looking at it. It took a while because my mom-in-law would say that ye ghar pe nahi hai, because you know, the idea has been that everything has to be there in the house, because at any point whoever comes and can ask for something, and the Indian hospitality means that you should be able to provide it. And I said, you know, mom, but in that way, what is happening is that you have diabetes, and I don't want my son to be eating it. I definitely don't want your son eating it. So the, what has happened, and I'm not interested in it. So what is happening is that, you know, we have something that just lies there, and then, you know, we are kind of either chucking it, and so hence we are wasting food, or we are doing something worse than wasting food, that is putting it into our bodies and making ourselves ill, even worse. So the idea was to not have it. Now, when there are certain, I'm not saying that you can never eat crisps. I love them too, and I do eat them. But you get them, there is certain thing, there's a birthday party happening, or there's somebody coming in. There are days when it comes in, gets over, but it's not something that comes in every week as your grocery list or in my monthly grocery list. I don't have any of sugary, candied stuff, you know, fried crisps, all sorts of junk food is just a no-no. Having said that, for my son, what has happened is from the time when he was younger, we've done this bargaining thing. So it's like, you give me little, I give you little. So in that zone of making the, like what I told you about almonds, making them interesting. In the same way, we try and make the rest of the food also interesting. You know, I want him to have the methi, and I know he'll make the methi rotis, you know, so they just become more interesting, and he's okay to eat it. So you just have to tweak everything a little bit, and it turns into healthy. Also, what I realized is, for my child, if I put in so many things in front of him, they're not needed, and then, you know, he's just getting distracted by it. So it also came down to doing your carb protein fiber, which, you know, schools are helping. Most of the schools are teaching you about nutrition, and they are, yes, now, because I think obesity and childhood diabetes and all has become a huge issue. So the in schools, they teach them, it's part of their curriculum. And if you can reinforce that at home, and have a conversation with the child's teacher in school, because, you know, when there are other kids in school also on the same path, it makes it easier. So there are times when I've had the, you know, when I've used my support group of school moms. And I think that is a great support group for any mother to have. And where you say that, you know what, I'm struggling with this and I need help with this. And, you know, everybody wants the best for their child. And if they can also, a couple of other moms can also kind of, and you know, you form those play dates where they are also serving healthy food, then, you know, you're suddenly not the only mother who is so boring and not serving anything fun. So it becomes kind of a norm. And while they're younger, you can still see to it that they go to play dates only to those houses where they're not going to serve them aerated drinks and all that. So for me, it was a big deal. Anywhere where there was junk food and aerated drink was crossed out, and my son wouldn't go there for a play date. Even if they thought I was being snobbish, I didn't care. But that was a very, very important thing, because, you know, yes, and at that age, I could do it. Now at 12, he'll say, Mama, come on. I said, but you are also 12 now, and you know what it is. Also telling him that every family has different rules, and this is our family's rule. So we sit down and we say that, okay, you wanted this gadget, how do you earn it? So this is the thing. So everything is a bit of an earning. And if he's been good, then, and he's understood something, then yes, we do reward him with the, you know, with the thing. So what has happened is, over a period of time now, we've come to a point where on holidays, when he is on a holiday, he'll say, Mama, I'm on holiday. Okay, this week, I'm not going to check you. Whatever you want, do it. But most of the year around, he keeps it for the holidays then, which, you know, is really definitely manageable. You're
already patterning their mind. Absolutely. To think in a certain way, and that is going to be an investment in him as
Absolutely.
An adult.
As an adult.
So that's a huge thing. I think we need to give a big round of applause. Ah,
thank you.
This.
So far, that's nice. How it's been working, and I've been trying to make that work. And, you know, so holidays, we are all going all out. But then on school days, and while, which is a longer part of the year in any case, we are doing only as far as.
Global Advertiser for innovative outdoor solutions.
Global as a company, it has never compromised on its service, quality, and commitment. And that is the reason our clients do keep on coming again and again to us for our service. The mission of the company is to rise on the graph of betterment for every campaign handled by us.
Sir, आपकी फिल्म द ग्रेट लीडर आ रही है, इस पर कुछ रोशनी डालिए।
रोशनी लीडर के साथ अपने आप चलती है, और हम क्या रोशनी डालेंगे उसके ऊपर। एक बहुत ही अच्छा विषय है इस फिल्म का, महिलाओं के प्रति जो है समाज में आजकल और कई गांवों में कई क्षेत्रों में अत्याचार होता है, उनको बढ़ावा नहीं दिया जाता, इसी के दायरे में ये कहानी बनी गई है। हीरो के पिता की भूमिका हम निभा रहे हैं और हमारी पत्नी जया जो है वो हमारी पत्नी का रोल कर रहे हैं। तो ये एक हिंदी वर्जन है, तो मुझे बड़ा गर्व है कि मैं इस फिल्म में काम कर रहा हूँ।
द ग्रेट लीडर फिल्म के निर्माता दीपक सावंत हैं, जो पिछले 45 वर्षों से आपके मेकअप आर्टिस्ट हैं। लोग जानना चाहते हैं कि शूटिंग पर दीपक सावंत आपकी नज़र में मेकअप आर्टिस्ट होते हैं या निर्माता?
ये मेकअप आर्टिस्ट पहले मेकअप हमारा करते हैं, उसके बाद ये निर्देशक बन जाते हैं।
इस फिल्म की सफलता के लिए आप दर्शकों से क्या कहना चाहेंगे?
ग्रेट लीडर जो है वो जा करके देखें, और मैं उम्मीद करता हूँ कि आपको पसंद आएगी और आपको सराहनीय लगेगी।
दीपक जी की फिल्म के लिए ग्लोबल एडवर्टाइजर्स ने बहुत सपोर्ट किया है, इस पर आप क्या कहना चाहेंगे?
हाँ, जिन लोगों ने इनको सपोर्ट किया है उनको हम धन्यवाद देते हैं, और इसी तरह उनको सहायता बनी रहे ताकि ऐसी फिल्मों का प्रचार हो, और उनको हमारी तरफ से बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं और अभिनंदन और स्नेह और आदर।
ग्लोबल एडवर्टाइजर फॉर इनोवेटिव आउटडोर सॉल्यूशंस।